Välkomna till dagens eller veckans kanske jag ska säga webbinar. Nu börjar vi med att få upp ånga. Jag tror det här är det sjunde som vi kör och vi har ett antal planerade framåt här hela hösten faktiskt. Är det så att ni vill se det här webbinariet igen så går det alldeles utmärkt. Jag lägger ut en länk i chatten till vår hemsida där vi har samlat alla webbinar som har varit. Förutom ett som av tekniska skäl det har försvunnit den inspelningen. Så den kan vi tyvärr inte ha med. Men där hittar ni alla gamla webbinar. Och även de kommande som ni ser högst upp nu så är det en länk till anmälan till det här webbinariet. Men till nästa så kommer det att ändra så kommer det finnas länk till att anmäla till de kommande också. Har ni frågor nu under själva webbinariet så är det bara skriv dem i chatten. Ni får skriva på engelska eller svenska. Skriver ni på svenska så översätter jag åt Gino. Eller jag brukar läsa frågorna från honom. Han brukar vara så inne i sin presentation. När det gäller dagens produkt då, LP652. Vi har fått redan innan har vi fått väldigt mycket frågor om den finns i hembryggarförpackning. Det gör den inte än utan det är 100 gram för tillfället. Men Gino har sagt att de ska väl internt avgöra om den ska lanseras framöver i hembryggarstorlek, vilket inte alls är omöjligt. Men han vet inte dagsläget när. Så att ni får gärna fråga det också, men det är det svaret ni kommer få. Those were the things I was forced to say in Swedish, so I didn't forget them. I now could switch over to English. Sorry for that, Gino.
No problem, no problem. I could almost follow it.
yeah. You speak Dutch, don't you?
Yes, yes.
That's quite similar, especially in Britain. Yeah, you can continue the presentation.
So you already discussed this?
I haven't discussed that, so you can mention. I haven't introduced myself. That I forgot, or you. So we can do that, yeah.
Okay.
I can introduce myself. I'm Jonas Schelén. I'm sales and marketing manager for Humlegården. Been working for 2.5 years now. Been a home brewer for at least 10 years. And use a lot of fermentis products, by the way. So I've known the company Humlegården long before I joined it. So that's me, short.
And me, I'm Gino. I work for Fermentis now a little bit over 3 years in sales, but I have quite a strong technical background. Not only in brewing, but also in other fields. I'll just go through the webinar guidelines now. I think most of you will know because most of you have joined before. So the presentation will be around 40 minutes and we always have room for questions, preferably afterwards. But if you have urgent questions, you can ask them to Jonas via the chat. And he can talk to me because we hear each other. We don't hear you because we are too many people. And that would become a bit chaotic. So you can ask Jonas via the chat and he can let you in the room if you want by sound of cam. So far, that hasn't happened before. So I'm
people
not sure.
Are shy.
I think you are all shy. And if you prefer, you can use the chat anyway. So today I'm going to talk about brewing kettle sour beer with Sour LP652, which is quite a new product we have at Fermentis. So before I start, I do a very short introduction on who we are. So we are a business unit of a big company called Le Safre. It's still family owned. We are involved in everything that has something to do with alcoholic beverages, so yeast for beer, cider, etc. We are based in Lille, which is just across the border with Belgium, so it's in France. This is a picture of the city. Maybe I should update that because it has been sitting here for ages already, the same picture. It's a nice city, so if you have time to visit, please do. The beer lineup is fantastic, actually, in the city, and the pubs also. Our factory is based in Belgium, so the place where all the brewing yeasts are produced is in Belgium, which is about 40 minutes drive. Actually, the product I'm talking about today, the LP652, is produced in France. It's in a completely different factory because, as you can imagine, this is a yeast factory and we don't want to put bacteria in a yeast factory. So this is a separate facility. So as mentioned, we work in the world of fermented beverages, beer, wine, cider, spirits, any drinkable alcohol. You can imagine we have products and solutions for that. In the past, I mainly focused on yeast, so in the past webinars, but the coming webinars, I will focus on different things. Today on bacteria, and then next week, or in 2 weeks, I think, on yeast derivatives. So at Fermentis, our current portfolio is 15 dry yeasts. And as I explained before, this portfolio will grow as soon as we see a need for new products. So some of the new products that we launched quite recently are the HA18, LA01, and the DA16. The DA16 is actually the newest product we have for the Brut IPA, I explained last week. But we also have other things, bacteria, functional products, and fermentation aids. And today I will talk about bacteria, obviously, in particular Lactobacillus plantarum, to produce sour beers. So let's first look a little bit into the sour beers to find some baseline for the presentation. Sour is one of the oldest beer styles around. If you Google, it might be even older. I think the first beer ever produced was a sour beer, actually, because back in those days they had no idea on hygiene, so they probably messed up their fermentations, which originally started all from bread that was just forgotten in fermentation, and then by accident some water was added and it started fermenting, and somebody drank this water and thought, hey, this has a nice taste, there's alcohol in it. And so that's how the first beer originated. So it's probably way longer than 1,000 years old. If you trace back time, I think if you trace back, the origin, which is in Belgium and Germany, I think you find numbers like 200-300 years ago, where you have the first lambic styles, available. So in Belgium, the main sour styles are lambic, Geuze, Faro, and Flanders Red Ale. I think most of you will know these styles. So lambics are, the classic sour beers. Geuze is actually blended lambic. So most of the times it's 1 year old beer blended with 3-year-old beer or 2-year-old. So these are blends. And Faro is lambic that is back sweetened. Flanders Red Ale is something more special, I would say, because this has, to my opinion, the most complex microbiology inside. Then in Germany, they also started with sours a long time ago. Very famous is the Berliner Weisse and the Geuze. I'm not sure how many of you guys try to brew one of these. If you don't have the facilities, I will show a little bit later on in the presentation, it's kind of undoable to reproduce any of these classic style beers, in particular the Belgian styles. So traditionally, these beers are aged in wooden barrels. And in the case of lambics, you have sometimes fruit additions. So you have the fruit lambics, like the sour cherries, they are called Kriek. If you are abroad and you see a bottle of Kriek, always try it. Most of the times these are very good because the sour cherries, they don't grow everywhere in the world. So in Belgium, actually, they have they are called the Schaarbeekse Kriek, which is a very special breed of sour cherry. and it's actually bought, the whole harvest is bought every year by the big breweries because the supply is still limited. We also have raspberry fruit beers, peach, apricot, you name it, but these are the most common ones. And just as an example, I put some famous sour beers here on the slide. So you have one from a small craft beer brewing company, Oud Beersel it's called. They have very nice Geuze. You have the Geuze Bone. I think this is also available in Sweden, this beer, because they are quite good in promoting and exporting their beers. Then you have the famous Cantillon. In Belgium, this is a very famous brewery. You have the Faro from Lindemans. Faro is not that easy to get, actually. It's only available in a more specialized shop, so it's not drank a lot. Then you have, and this plate biggest of all, because it's my personal favorite beer in the world, is the Rodenbach, and in particular this one, the vintage 2015. It's, to my opinion, the best beer in the world. It's extremely complex, but extremely drinkable and very refreshing. So if you ever get a hand, I mean, I can buy it because there are shops close by, but if you are ever in the neighborhood, make sure to pick up one of these and take them home, because you will experience something very new. And I found this one, Kölschon. It's an American brewery who is producing Geuze, just to indicate that it's not limited anymore just to Belgium and Germany. You have the Berliner Weisse here, and then the fruit additions to the Liefmans, in this case, the Lindemans Lambic Framboise. So this one is with sour cherries. This one is with raspberry. So as you can see, most of these bottles look quite, quite chic, I would say, with corks. And that's because, you know, these beers, like this Geuze, has been aged for at least 3 years. So it makes these products quite exceptional. And most of the time you see that back in the packaging, obviously. So if you look on the Brewing Judge certification program, the style guidelines, we find four groups that could contain acidic or sour beers. Most well known ones are 23 and 27. So the European sour ales with the beers I just mentioned, you have 27 with the historical beers, which contains the Geuze, and also a beer called Lichtenhainer. I never heard of this beer, to be honest, but it's a smoked sour ale. And then you have the more newer ones. So in group 28, you have the American wild ale, so which contains beers from mixed fermentation, so typical sour beer also. So also on the other side of the ocean, things are picking up, especially, you know, since some famous brewers like the one from Rodenbach started quite a long time ago now at New Belgium Brewing, where he also introduced all his knowledge on barrel aging and doing fermentation in fooders in wooden barrels. Last but not least, 34, the specialty beers. As you all know, this is the category that fits all beers that could not fit into any other category. So normally this should not contain sour beers, but it is possible. If you want to take a look at all the styles and all the style descriptions, you can follow a link to this website. So what all these have in common is obviously being acidic, being sour, and some of them are also tart. So they have this very typical aftertaste. So let's look into this sour acidic part, specifically the acids. So I just summed up some acids for you to get a feel on what we are looking for. So yogurt is something that that everybody knows. It's sour due to lactic acid, and in this case that is caused by lactobacillus that ferments the lactose from the milk. And that brings a little bit sourness. And as most of you have probably tasted yogurt, you will experience quite a gentle, nice sourness. It's not harsh. Then wine. Wine is sour due to the presence of acids in the grapes, but also due to different acids produced in fermentation. So in grapes, for instance, you have tartaric acid, malic acid, citric acid, and fermentation adds additional acids like, for instance, acetic acid, succinic acid, butyric acid, which is not a nice one actually, but it sometimes happens. So if you look at, you know, more general products, Coca-Cola, why is this so sour? Well, it's because they add a lot of phosphoric acid. A lemon, it's the sourness comes from citric acid. Vinegar, the sourness comes obviously from acetic acid. And this is, as we call that, the so-called harsh sourness. So if you compare a tablespoon of lactic acid and if you taste it and taste a tablespoon of vinegar, you will know that you perceive a much more harsh sourness from vinegar than from lactic acid. And we have green apples, which are sour because of malic acid present in the apple. And then, as an example, soy sauce, which can also be a little bit acidic, depending on the soy sauce, of course, but that comes from mainly lactic acid. So if you look at the pH of these common drinks, I have here from acidic to neutral. So this goes from pH very low to pH 7. The most sour or most acidic beer or drink on the market now is I think Coca-Cola. It's the pH is 2.5. That's why it's so bad for your teeth. Then you have the white wines, which are around 3.4. The ale beers, which are normally between 4-4.5. Yogurts, 4.3-4.4. Lagers, 4.4-4.7. Some also are at 4.2. Coffee 4.5 to 6, and then you have milk, which is already quite neutral, and then here at pH 7 you have water. So where in this picture are the sour beers? Anybody have any idea? I don't see nobody responding, so
no one is typing.
Nobody is typing. Cola. Lars thinks cola. Okay. And then we have Patrick coming. 3 years and up. Yes, Patrick is completely right. Sorry, Lars. It's indeed, it's here in the range of 3-ish, 3.2, 3.5. So it's not as sour as the Coca-Cola. So talking about pH and acidity, I should explain, I think, a little bit the difference, because pH is something that most of us can measure, even as a home brewer. And it's actually what you measure is the electric potential between two electrons with the pH meter. And what you do is you measure the concentration of dissociated hydrogen ions, so the H pluses. To be clear, this gives no indication on the total acids in the solution. So if you talk about perceiving acidity, just the pH is a little bit limited to figure out the total perceivable acidity of your beer. For that, you need to do a total acidity analysis. Fancy apparatus available for that, like HPLCs. And with that, the total acidity, you measure actually the total of all dissociated, but also the undissociated acid compounds in solution. So this overall gives the total value of all acids and also the perceivable acidity. So this is more close to what you could perceive as a person compared to just the pH. So since most of us don't have a fancy HPLC laying around, I would recommend just simply taste, because taste is still, you know, the best equipment in the world. Taste says a lot more than any apparatus. It's nice that they are in line, and tasting is free, and also most of the times quite nice. if you want to change total acidity in your beer, you can increase it or decrease it actually by adding lactic acid. So increase total acidity by adding lactic acid. If you want to decrease it, you can add like a potassium bicarbonate, so any or any other weak base that will increase your pH and decrease your total acidity. So now let's go to the microorganisms involved in sour beers. Obviously, in the sour beer process, you have also the traditional Saccharomyces. I will explain later where they are. Sometimes you have Pastorianus also, lager-based beers. Sometimes Baianus, so the wine yeast. Obviously, as most of you know, also the Brettanomyces. And these two are the main ones, the Brettanomyces anomalus and the Brettanomyces brucellensis. In addition to bacteria, and most of them are lactic acid bacteria. So in this group, you have the Lactobacillus, the Pediococcus and the Enococcus. Lactobacillus, obviously you have again different species. Today I will focus on the Lactobacillus plantarum, but you also have the Brevis, you have the Delbrueckii, and all have specific features that can attribute to your sour beer. And they all belong to the same group of lactic acid bacteria. So Pediococcus is also a quite normal bacteria to have. Also the Enococcus. Pediococcus is normally added after or ends up in your sour after the fermentation has occurred. And in some cases, people refer to these, if you brew a normal beer, as spoilers. But in the case of sour beers, obviously you want them in your system. And there's one last one I want to mention is Acetobacter, which is also quite a common bacteria in for beer, actually. But this one is really a spoiler. So it's also not desired in any sour beers. Acetobacter is a bacteria that converts alcohol into acetic acid. So to my knowledge, this one is only desired in one process, and that's the kombucha process, where you want to convert alcohol into acids, because in most kombuchas you don't want to have alcohol. So what do these different organisms produce? Well, as I already mentioned in several webinars, we have the normal classical yeast that produce esters, higher alcohol, so fruity floral notes, alcoholic notes. The POF positive ones will produce phenol, so the spicy notes. You can have sulfury notes, you can have acids, and many, many more. This is virtually unlimited. A yeast could easily produce hundreds of compounds in a single beer. Then you have, for the sours more specifically, the Brettanomyces. Brettanomyces are known to be able to add apple, pineapple, dark tropical fruit to beer, but more commonly, and that's what we know them for, are the funky flavors. I don't know who ever came up with the term funky, because if you look at the flavors that are funky, you have to think about horse sweat, horse blanket, barnyard flavors. Earthy flavors, cheesy mushroom. This all doesn't sound like very nice in beer. But in a sour beer and in the amount that is contributed to the final flavor, it can be nice. It's a bit of a personal preference, I would say. Personally, I'm not really into these very funky flavors. So all these wild ale style beers that have a lot of horse sweat flavor or barnyard in them are a bit too wild for me. So I would not consider them funky, but that's how they name it. Most important attribute from in terms of flavor by Brettanomyces is obviously acetic acid. This is a very well-known acid produced by the Brettanomyces. Then we have bacteria, as I already mentioned, Lactobacillus, where you have the lemony tart flavor, which comes from lactic acid, but it can also add some tropical fruit notes and more dairy-like notes, as I will show also later on in the presentation. The Pediococcus, similar, but this one is quite well known to also produce buttery flavor, so diacetyl. And in many cases, this is not an issue because it will be cleaned up by the yeast later on in the process, especially if you do a kettle sour. But still, if you have, you know, the traditional process where everything comes together at the same time, then this could be an issue. Then you have the Oenococcus, which is the same. It's a bit tart. It's a little bit less lemony producing. But it does produce also the buttery flavor, diacetyl, which can be a problem if you don't want that in your beer. One thing I want to say about the Oenococcus is that it's very tolerant to alcohol and OPA. So that's why it's often used. I'm saying here used after souring. I would say now, if I look at it, it's often present after souring, because this one can survive in quite harsh conditions. So if you look at the traditional sour beer brewing process, I just made it quite simple. It looks a little bit like this. So you start normally with a normal mash, often not a very high gravity mash, because normally sour beer styles have quite a normal alcohol level, around 5%. So after the mash, you do the lautering and then you do the boil. In the boil, you add hops. And in the case of sour beers, this is often old hops. So you don't want fresh hoppy notes in a sour beer. That's not in style. To my opinion, new style kind of sour beers could be quite nice if you add some hoppiness to it. But in the old-fashioned traditional sour beer, this is always old hops. So they take hops from 3 or 4 years old that has been completely oxidized, and does not have many of these nice hoppy aromas present anymore. It just adds some bitterness. So then after the boil and clarification, you end up cooling the wort, and you do that in a cool ship. I don't know if anybody of you ever saw a cool ship. These are actually quite cool. They cool, but they are also quite cool to see, especially the classic ones. I'm showing here the one at Cantillon, so the Belgian lambic brewery. It's fully in copper, as you can see, so it looks quite impressive. And in all breweries, the cool ship is always on the roof, on top of the building. So what they do is they open the window, so you see a window here with blinds. Yeah, you don't see it really clearly, but once the wort is in, and they let it cool down, and they open the blinds so air can pass through. And in this air, there is always bugs around, bacteria and yeast, and these inoculate actually the wort. It's a spontaneous fermentation. That sounds really romantic, but it's a bit more complex, the story, because there are not that many yeasts and bacteria flying around in the sky. And they claim they are, especially in this part of the world, in the so-called Zenne Valley, so the Zenne Valley, which is the valley that where all the lambics and geuses are produced. But actually, these beers have been produced for many, many years in this environment, in this cool ship. So all the microorganisms are actually in the room. So they live on the wood and on the walls and everywhere. So you have, because of the long use of the yeast and the bacteria, they develop a so-called microclimate. And in all these cool ship rooms, there is a microclimate present. So they open the blinds to get some airflow, but actually you get a lot of also internal airflow by doing that. And most of the bacteria and yeast simply come from the room itself. And that also makes it quite unique. So every, you know, sour beer brewery has a unique microclimate, and therefore they also produce a unique beer. It's very hard to copy. This is very hard to do. Then next, once it is inoculated, it's transferred nowadays often just to normal conical fermenters, but not always. Sometimes they are also transferred to fooders, or a part of it is transferred to fooders. So you could have a first primary fermentation for, I don't know, a week or two, and then it's transferred to the fooders to complete the fermentation. So you have all kinds of options. At Rodenbach, they do it in fooders. Rodenbach is a beautiful brewery. If you have the opportunity to visit, please do. They have a fantastic restaurant where you can do a pairing of food with the different types of Rodenbach they produce. These are big wooden fermenters. And all these fermenters have a microclimate inside. In this case, the microclimate and the microbiology involved is not present in the air, obviously, but it's present in the wood. So in the wood, there you have simply a population of organisms that likes the wort that is being produced and also lives on this wort and by that delivers, you know, very specific flavors. To be able to copy a Rodenbach is impossible, I would say. You can never copy it because this brewery has been there for a long time and it's so unique. I would say it's virtually impossible, or you have to have a lot of time. So what do they do if one of these fooders, is broken or starts leaking or needs to be refurbished? They don't take out the complete barrel, but they just take out parts. So they take out one or two planks and put new ones in, but leave always a large part of the old planks inside because those contain the microbes that you want and that you need to produce the beer. So most of us don't have this. Most craft breweries don't have this. And at home, you for sure don't have this. So that's why we have the kettle sour process. I'm getting there, guys, don't worry. I'm getting closer to the subject. So the kettle sour process looks quite similar, obviously without a cool ship. So also here you start with mashing and lautering. And then from the lautering, you go to the boiling kettle. You can choose to boil the wort, but some people, you know, prefer to have completely sterile conditions before adding the bacteria. But actually, that's not required because in a normal mashing program, a normal mashing scheme, you have been at least at 63 for quite a long time, and you mash off at 72, 78. So minimal, you are at high temperature for at least 1 hour, which already pasteurized your complete wort. So, you know, this is only for the guys that say, okay, I really want to be sure and have completely a sterile wort. Then you could choose a short boil, but I personally would not do that. I would simply cool it and then to a temperature of 30 to 40 degrees for lactics, and then add the bacteria in the boiling kettle. And then you wait for a certain time. I will show data, obviously, and then you go to the boil. So in the boil, you kill all the bacteria present, and then you follow the traditional process further on. It's important to boil, obviously, because you don't want any bacteria in the rest of your process, and you don't want to mess up your brewery with bacteria, because they can contaminate the other beers. So this is an important step to include. So what happens, let's talk about lactobacillus first, because that's the one that we are talking about today for the lactic fermentation. So lactobacillus, first on the genus, what is it? it's a gram positive bacteria, and gram was a guy that did a lot of analysis on cell membranes, some cell membranes of bacteria are gram positive, so they are different than the gram negative bacteria. I will not go into detail. As you can see, they are far away from fungi. So it's a completely different lineage in the tree of life. So these have not that much in common. But as you will see, some like very basic metabolic pathways, obviously they have in common because they are general for all domains of life. So the lactobacillus is a gram-positive cell. It's rod-shaped, as you can see here. It's like 0.5 to 0.8 micrometers wide and 3 to 8 micrometers long. Sometimes it's, as shown here, as single cells. Sometimes it's in pairs. Sometimes it's in a train of cells, so in a short chain. And lactobacillus has a very large genome, one of the largest of the lactic acid bacteria. And it's very flexible and versatile because of this. I don't know by heart how much of the genome has been resolved, but I think it's not more than 50-60%. So there's still a lot of things to discover for this species. Because of the large genome size, it's very likely that it can grow in a wild pH range, so between 3.2 and 8.8. It can grow in a wide temperature range between 12 and 40 degrees, and it can also grow in the presence of oxygen. So it's quite a unique genus. So let's go into detail in one of the lactic acid bacteria, which is Lactobacillus plantarum. We have selected this after intensive screening and selection. I showed a little bit in the LA01 presentation how that works. So we start up with a big collection, and then we simply do a lot of tests to figure out which one would be the best. So a lot of fermentations, different conditions. I will skip all that in this presentation. Where does the name come from? So LP is from Lactobacillus plantarum. 652, I don't know. It's probably strain 652 that has been selected from the vault out of I don't know how many Lactobacillus plantarum strains we have. So it's homofermentative, I'll go into that later, and it can produce a balanced flavor profile with some release of tropical fruity notes, citrus notes, which results in a nice fresh sensation. So typically sours are summer beers, and they are most drunk in the summer. It's easy to use, like most of the products, and so far only available in 100 gram packaging. As a home brewer, I also hope that this will change in the future, but at this moment we only have 100 grams. So let's go back to this kettle souring process and look what's happening in this fermentation. Well, obviously in this case, glucose is converted into lactate, and that goes through this reaction. So glucose goes to the normal glycolysis, or EMP, which is Enden-Meyerhof-Parnas pathway. It's the three guys that discovered this pathway in the past, to pyruvate, and from pyruvate is converted to lactate. Also here shown in light, it's also possible that you can produce a little bit of acetate with this, but it's a very limited amount compared to lactate. So the majority is lactate in this case. In terms of numbers, lactate, acetate, you have to think at least tenfold more lactic acid compared to acetic acid. So the contribution of acetic acid is limited. We are not even looking at that because lactic is dominant. Then in the second phase, you obviously have the normal fermentation. So once you have kettle soured and you boil, you clarify, you cool, and you end up in fermentation. And in fermentation, the usual thing happens. I showed this before. Glucose and other sugars are converted into ethanol and CO2. And this is what brings the bubbles in your beer. While lactic fermentation does not, obviously, it produces lactic acid and no CO2. So in the brewery, how does it work? So this is a bit summing up. You start with your malt and your mash, and you end up with fermentable sugars. Normally about 10 to 15% is glucose, but you also have maltose, maltotriose, and dextrins. These are the dextrins are normally unfermentable, so they end up as residual sugars. Depending on the yeast, also maltotriose can end up as residual sugar. Normally, glucose and maltose are all converted. Well, in the kettle souring, you first do a lactic acid fermentation, where you convert the glucose into lactic acid and also into aromas. And I only show a little bit of coloration here because the contribution of the typical aromas from the lactic acid fermentation is obviously less than the aromas produced in the alcoholic fermentation. So once you acidify the wort, you do a normal fermentation and you produce your ethanol CO2, but also glycerol, several other acids, biomass, as I explained before. And you end up also sometimes with residual sugars like dextrins or maltotriose. In total, about 5% of the sugars that you put in end up in the biomass. The rest all goes to these nice other compounds. So let's go into more detail on LP652 and in particular the characterization that we did. So I will show results of four main experiments we did with this strain, where we looked at the impact of pitching rate, the impact of wort density, temperature, and agitation first of all, the pH, and also the production of organic acids, which we measured by HPLC at different times during the fermentation. So let me go first into the first one. So the impact of pitching rate on acidification and lactic acid production. In this case, we use two pitching rates, 10 gram per hectoliter and 100 gram per hectoliter, starting from a 12 plato wort. And this is made normally with Pilsner malt, so no any fancy roasted malts or whatsoever, simple Pilsner malt at 30 degrees, and it was a static fermentation. So no mixing. Let's look at the pH, which is shown here on the y-axis, and the time on the x-axis, done at two different pitching rates. So the solid line here is 10 gram per hectoliter. The dashed line is 100 gram per hectoliter pitching. And as you can see, that the process is done after around 24 to 36 hours. So there's not much happening in this last part anymore. And what we also see that at somewhat higher pitching, it goes a bit faster, which is kind of logical, but you end up at a somewhat lower pH, but it's not that much lower. Look at the scale between 3 and 3.5. So here it's maybe like, 0.1, 0.2 difference in pH. So there's not much impact from the amount. So you could, already conclude that a lower amount is already sufficient for your souring process. Then lactic acid production, as I mentioned, to have an idea on the total perceivable acidity of your sour beer, it's important to look at total acids. And the main one produces lactic acid. So here I show on the y-axis lactic acid in gram per liter, on the x-axis for two pitching rates. So for instance, at 10 gram per hectoliter pitching, we found after 24 hours about 2.5 gram per liter lactic acid. If we pitch a bit higher, 100 gram per hectoliter, we find 4. After 48 hours, we find about twice more, so a little bit less than twice, but to make it simple, about twice more. And in the case of the 100 gram per liter, a little bit less than twice more. So also here you see, if you pitch higher, you have more lactic acid production, which is kind of logical. But if you think back one slide and look at the pH, it doesn't mean that your pH shift is that much more. So here you have a higher total acidity, but without having a way higher pH, a way lower pH. So this is something to keep in mind.
Gino, we have a question.
Yes.
Yeah, Patrick, no need for pre-souring, just mash as usual, cool to 30, 40 degrees and add LP652 and wait, question mark. Some producers want you to pre-sour to say 4.5 pH.
Well, that's depending on you as a brewer. Normally, in beer production, the pH of the mash is around 5.2. Some are a bit higher, some are at 5.6. But when I was still working for Leuven University, we had one guy that did a PhD on this process, and he found out that the best aromatic profile and the best flavor stability was reached when you mash in at a pH of 5.2. So at Fermentis, we always start and we always mash around this pH of 5. So pre-souring to 4.5, I don't think so. Look here, if you we start here at 5 and we end up at 3.5, between 3.2 and 3.5. If you already start at 4.5, you will probably end up also between 3.2 and 3.5, because Lactobacillus plantarum cannot go to the pH it can handle. If you have other bacteria, like the Enococcus, for instance, that can go lower in pH, but this one produces, you know, this unpleasant diacetyl. So,
but it will speed up the process, though. If you pre-sour it.
You just start lower, but as I mentioned, what is important in perceivable acidity of your beer is the total acid produced. So I'm quite sure that after 24 hours, if you start with a lower pH, you will not end up with a much more lactic acid production. My gut feeling would say you might produce less, because the conditions are becoming less favorable for the lactobacillus. As I mentioned, it can grow between, say, 3.2 and 8.8. So the optimum would be somewhere in the middle, I would say. I'm not sure what the optimum is for growth of Lactobacillus plantarum exactly. There's also no need to discover that. But if you start lower, you already are going towards the lower end of what is possible. So I would expect, I would not expect more lactic acid production if you pre-sour.
So no need for pre-souring then?
No. If you want to produce a sour-like beer, or a beer that has some sourness, and if you use these soured malts, for instance, you can skip basically kettle souring if you base yourself on to starting with a malt like that. In this case, I'm discussing a normal malt bill, a normal mash profile, and then to convert this one into a sour. This is done more in the classic way to produce a sour beer. The sour mashes are more typical flavor attributes to existing styles, I would say. I don't know if the maltsters are happy with me if I'm saying that, but I'm not a maltster, so it's for me it's a bit of a walking on thin ice discussing acidic malts. But I would say, to conclude, you don't need to pre-sour.
Okay.
So next, impact of word density on acidification and lactic acid production. In this case, we did 8, 12, and 16 Plato words. which we pitched with 10 gram per hectoliter bacteria at 30 degrees and again static fermentation. So let's look into that. Here I again show pH versus time. And as you can see, the blue line is 8 Plato, the orange line is 12 Plato, and the gray line is 16 Plato. So at the lower Platos, you see the fastest response. It ends up at the expected pH of around 3.5. At 16 Platos, it ends up a little bit higher. I'm not sure why. It could be that the amount of glucose present in this 16 Plato wort is a little bit different, or you could have an effect from osmotic stress. I don't expect that, but this is what we observed, so that's why I'm showing it. 16 Plato is already on the high side, as you produce way more alcohol than is desired for a sour beer. But anyway, it's possible because you still end up at a pH of 3.6, which is fine to start from your next fermentation, which is alcoholic, which will also lower the pH a bit more. Then lactic acid production, again, to explain the total acidity at 8, 12, and 16 Platos here on the x-axis and lactic acid on the y-axis. So the gray bars are 24 hours and the blue bars are 48 hours. You can see that for the lower Platos, you have a little bit of an increase from 8 to 12 Plato, maybe like 0.5 gram per liter. But from 12 to 16, you don't see this. So, and also after 48 hours, these differences are very limited. And it's my gut feeling that this has something to do with the amount of glucose present in this 16 Plato wort. Because it can be a lot of maltose and maltotriose, other sugars present, more than in this 12 Plato wort. In terms of conclusion for lactic acid production, we see obviously that at lower wort density, you have a somewhat lower lactic acid production. Is this really relevant? I'm not sure, because what's most important is that we see lactic acid production, and this follows, you know, a trend that you can expect. If you wait a little bit longer, you end up with somewhat higher lactic acid concentration. This is something that you would expect. So the impact of temperature on acidification and again lactic acid production at these temperatures, 30, 37, 40, 45, and 50, pitched again in 12 Plato wort, 10 gram per hectoliter LP652, again a static fermentation. So let's look at the results. First again, pH versus time. Yellow is 50 degrees, gray 45, orange 40, and blue 37. You can see at 50 and at 45 degrees, it's not working really well. At 40 degrees, it's still working. And at 37, it's more optimal. Reason is quite obvious. Lactobacillus is a species that is was first isolated from humans, actually. It's present in everybody's mouth in quite nice amounts in your saliva. So thinking about it in your word, you could end up with a soured beer. Unfortunately, there are more than only lactobacillus in your mouth. There are around 30,000 different species living in your mouth. So spitting in the word is not a solution if you want to save money, for instance. But that explains the 37 degrees. We are all 37 degrees, so obviously the optimal temperature for Lactobacillus plantarum is also 37 degrees. It also works at a little bit higher temperatures, which is interesting because this is something that you can use to control a little bit your sourness. If you want to have a little bit less sourness or less acidic beer, you could increase the temperature a little bit, maybe not at the start of the pitch, but during the pitch. So you have some flexibility there. Then lactic acid production, and here you clearly see the advantage of being at an optimal temperature Again, lactic acid on the y-axis, different temperature on the x-axis. Gray again, 24 hours, and blue, 48 hours. You see the most lactic acid production at 37 degrees after 24, but also obviously after 48 hours. And here you see the impact of a little bit too high temperature. So maybe half of the bacteria is half dead already at this temperature. And remember, 40 degrees also for humans is a bit warm already. And it similar goes for a bacterium that is working outside its optimal temperature. It still lives, but it doesn't like it. And then you see it back, in this case, in the lactic acid production. It's less productive. At higher temperature, it's almost dropped to zero. So there's almost no contribution. So if you want to select an optimal temperature, you have to be at 37 or maybe a little bit lower, even if you would prefer that. Then last but not least, the impact of acidification, of agitation on acidification. This was just an experiment done to see, you know, if stirring of the wort would help. So we kind of simulated that by doing experiments at 100 RPM and without any stirring. Again, pitching at in 12 plate of wort, 10 gram per hectoliter, and fermenting at 30 degrees. Here I will only show pH in this case, with the solid line being the static and the dashed line being the one that has been agitated, so at 100 RPM. And you see there's not really a significant difference. The agitations seem to go a little bit faster, but in the end you reached the same pH. And even if you look a little bit before, you know, you are looking here between 3 and 3.5. So this is already in a normal error range of a pH meter. So, you know, maybe you can see a little bit of difference here, but if you go down, the differences are not significant. So next important question, what about the organoleptic profile? What about the taste of LP652? So for this, we did other experiments, which I'll show the methodology now. So first we made again a 12 Plato wort based on Pilsner malt of 12 Plato, split it up in three parts. One part we pitched 10 gram per hectoliter, one part we pitched 100 gram per hectoliter, and then we didn't pitch at all. We just send in the fermented wort. For the ones that are pitched, we did fermentations for 48 hours at 30 degrees. Why 48 hours? I don't know. Obviously because it was easy. And it was also part of the experiments, most likely also to really find you know, the best possible option in terms of flavor development. In this case, the sensory analysis was done by a little bit smaller panel. We used 22 people. Normally we have at least 40, but for these experiments it was 22. And then we looked at these descriptors, so volatile acidity, dairy, fruity notes, malty, cereal, acidity, obviously a sweetener, bitterness, honey, and sulfury. So let's look at the results, which I will show here in a spider plot. So here you have the flavor descriptors around and the scale from 0 to 8, which is quite a common scale in sensory analysis. And first look at the wort. So wort is the orange line. And as you can see, what do you pick up sensory wise? You pick up malty flavors, cereal, honey, and a lot of sweetness, as expected. Then if you acidify with pitched 10 gram per hectoliter of lactobacillus, which is the light blue line, you see already the landscape changing. So your malty is dropping, your cereal perception is dropping, honey, sweet acidity is going up. For 100 gram per hectoliter, the results are actually very, very similar. As you can see, the differences are all within one scale, so it's almost nothing except for the acidity. You see it's one step further, so you go from 4 to 5 in this case. I'm not sure. I mean, it's perceived in this case. I'm not sure if you are an untrained drinker, if you would pick this up yourself. This type of difference. And normally you have to look 2 or 3-fold changes in scale to really pick up the sensory, because this is a complex palette of flavors. Last but not least, we also see a 2-fold increase in fruitiness. So there is an addition of fruity notes. There is also some addition of dairy notes, so milk-like notes in the beer. Most significant, obviously, the acidity. And with that, I reach to the final conclusions for LP652. As you can conclude from the graphs I've shown, a pitching rate of 10 gram per hectoliters is more than enough to complete the fermentation between 24 to 36 hours. Which is handy. It's like 2 days, so it's a handy, practical working pace. Temperature range 30 to 40 degrees, and 37 is optimal. Final pH will be around 3.2, 3.6, and you can fine tune this acidification by varying the pitching rate. So if you pitch a little bit more, you will produce a little bit more lactic acid. You can also change the word density. So if you increase the word density a little bit, you will sour a little bit less. Or obviously you can vary the time. If you wait a little bit longer, you might end up a little bit lower. Although we did not see any decrease after 48 hours anymore. Sensory wise, we see an increase in acidity, obviously, but also some fruitiness and dairy perception. So fruity notes are added to the beer. We see decrease in malty and sweetness perception, logical, and the pitching rate has impact on the flavor perception, but it is quite limited, as you saw in the last spider plot. And with that, I reached the end. I want to highlight again the Fermentis app. I'm not sure how many of you have downloaded it already. I hope all of you. Because the more people have it, the more effort will be put in to improve this this app. So
I use it, and I can recommend it warmly. It's a very good app, I must say.
Okay, thanks a lot. And with that, we have 2 more planned webinars to go, because as you know, I promised to also work on counter pressure fermentation. I'm doing that in between when I have time. I'm looking into the literature on that, so there will be a webinar on that subject later. In 2 weeks we will do the webinar on Spring Blanche, October 29th, and then we have one that should have been earlier in this kind of structured lineup, but we started in a different way. We started with New England IPA somewhere in the middle, and then we just went along. And this will be on rehydration versus direct pitching. A lot of you guys have already heard this story, but maybe some of you have not, and it's an interesting story. So with that, I thank you very much again for participating. If you have time, please complete the questionnaire, because it helps me and also Fermentis a lot in where to go in development. So if you say we need, for instance, we need a smaller pack size for the LP652, put it in this questionnaire, because it will be read by many people. And this is the way to make changes. If you want me to discuss other topics, other specific yeasts or whatever, you can leave that in this questionnaire, and I will at the end of the cycle I will combine every all the info and come up with answers and probably a new webinar program. So questions, guys, or was everything clear, or everybody fell asleep already? I don't know.
Patrick is on the keyboard again.
Yes.
And you can, of course, also mail me if you have any question, if it's regarding assortment at Humlegården or whatever. Oh, now we have three people.
Ah, Lars is sleeping. Thank you, Lars, for this nice compliment. Then Patrick asks the question, are you planning on releasing yeast that sours and ferments at the same time? Yeah, the only one that is possible in doing that first of all yeast produce acids and sour the wort, that sour the beer. That's why you go from a normal wort pH of 5.2 to say 4.2, so you have one drop in pH. But I guess you mean going a little bit lower than that. Only Brettanomyces species can do that. Obviously, these ones are we are looking into alternative yeasts for souring. Also into other bacteria, but so far it's not ready yet. I think you can imagine that we follow the market, we follow the trends, but we also try to create trends and create markets. So I'm a little bit far away from the whole decision making process in terms of okay, what will come next. Sometimes I hear some things. So, but that's about it. I cannot, share much details on where we are going. Obviously, as you saw in the cycle of the webinars, there are quite a lot of new products launched the past year. We have two brewing yeasts. We have the LP652, which has launched this year, the LA01. We have four new cider yeasts on the market, or three new cider yeasts and one existing. So in total now four cider yeasts, which are actually quite nice. I also made cider myself. As a brewer, you can do that easily. It's quite a clean process also. So especially if you start from apple concentrate. It doesn't mess up your system as much as working with barley malt, and you can make great products with that. So I think a marketing decision on what is next in line to market, but it's not my decision. I don't know.
Might be a good topic, cider, for a webinar, maybe.
Yes, I totally agree on that. I am collecting data. It's so new that we have some things available, but to my personal opinion, that's not up to the level that I'm used to present. So I want to share some more data to give you a good idea on what you can do with each individual yeast. Otherwise, it would become too much of a sales pitch, and I prefer this Fermenters Academy way, more educational, share knowledge and data, and then you as brewers decide yourself if it's something for you. If I hope I'm convincing enough, that you want to try it out. Conditions that we tried, or I think you know what I mean. If it becomes too much of a commercial talk, it doesn't fit into the Ferments Academy profile anymore, to my opinion. So as soon as I have enough data available. I know the data is there. It just simply has to be approved by some people to share this data. I will do a webinar on ciders for sure, because you can do great things with cider. I made myself a very nice dry hopped cider with Citra, And it's amazing in the summer, in the sunshine. It's an amazing drink to have. It's obviously high in alcohol, and very sparkling. But most important, it's very refreshing, and it's something different than beer. It has somewhat of a lighter body, so you experience it a bit different. So definitely.
I tried it myself as well. I have a couple of apple trees in the garden, and
nice.
So it's not many liters, but it's nice to try a different way of fermented.
Yeah,
I haven't tried with hops though.
It's some amazing. Colleagues.
I've tried someone, but I haven't done it myself.
Okay, you should, because that brings the beer into the cider. The hoppy aromas really go well with to also mask a little bit the apple flavor. Personally, I'm not a big fan of ciders because of the strong malic acid, appley, acetaldehyde flavor in cider. But if you add hops, this completely disappears. You have a hoppy lemonade like drink, which is very nice. It's bone dry, so you can ferment out completely to zero, which also makes it calorie wise an interesting drink to have in the summer.
Sounds more like an excuse to drink.
Indeed. You're not buying it. I understand, Jonas. Oh, we have Patrick ask, is there one out there that contains Lancia from another company? I don't know. I don't know if Lancia is on the market yet. It could be. There are several companies obviously putting bacteria on the market also, both liquid and dry. In dry form, it's a little bit more complicated than liquid, obviously. So in liquid form, there are more options available already. There's also a downside because, these cultures don't stay alive for that long. So you have to, have fresh yeasts, fresh packs, and use it quite fast. So if you are living close to a brew shop, it's easy. But normally, if you start sending yeasts around or bacteria around, it doesn't really help in terms of quality. So they have a limited shelf life. Mm-hmm. Looking forward to to using myself. Very good. I answered your email, Patrick. I don't know if you already saw it. I hope it helped. So Lancia is not there yet. Okay. That one ferments and sours while the fermenter. I'm not sure if Lancia has this so-called GRAS status, so generally regarded as safe. If it is produced in any other food chain, normally it is it has the GRAS status. So this is the status that the European Union gives to organisms when they are accepted as being safe. They have been tested in a laboratory or historically. So for instance, Saccharomyces cerevisiae has GRAS status because historically it has been used for many, many years. In beer brewing, you have several other species. Lactobacillus plantarum has GRAS status because it has been used in food productions for many, many years, and nobody got sick from that. With Lancia, I don't know if this has a GRAS status. If not, it will not end up on the market. So you might read about it in literature, but in the end, those the organisms that don't have the GRAS status never end up in on the market. I know there is a GMO yeast now available on the market that also does is producing sourness, but it's a genetically modified one. So in Europe, we cannot use it. At the West, can use it. I'm not sure if people want to do that. I have no experience with this yeast, but you know, we'll see what the future brings. There could be you know, organisms that get this grass status. There could be maybe genetically modified organisms in the future used also in Europe to produce beer. But so far, no, it's not an option.
Okay.
More questions? If not, then we see each other in 2 weeks.
Yeah, in 2 weeks then.
2 weeks, and, yes.
And you can find the link where to sign up for the webinar on our webpage. I put it in the chat in the beginning of this webinar, so you can always go there and check. And you will also find the link to this webinar as well there as soon as we get it. Last time, I think it took a day.
Yes, I think it's not always working, actually. I put some automation in this system. And normally, everybody that registered for this webinar should receive an email automatically with a link. But I already found out with other webinars that that is not always the case. So I don't know why. We are in contact with the company EDUDIP that has this, that has built this platform. So I will check and hope. And otherwise, you can find it on the web webpage also.
Yeah, so exactly. So two ways. Either you use the one that you get mailed to you, or you can check in our website.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Gino.
Yes, thanks a lot, guys.
It's a pleasure.
And Jonas, yeah, for your support.
Wasn't so much.
Still, it's a nice Swedish introduction. I could not repeat that for sure. And you bring the crowd, eh? You have the contacts to join at this webinar, which is very important for us. Yeah, so thank you for that.
I think it's our customers that are very happy that you are doing these seminars with us. So they are very appreciated. So
good, good. And guys, if you want other subjects, you know, fill in the questionnaires and I will look into it. Okay, I wish you a very good weekend already. If you want to see another webinar, I'm also doing them in other countries. So if the timing for this one is not right, you can also join at another date because other webinars are behind in schedule. So I'm, for instance, tomorrow doing it in Denmark, Norway, and Finland, and we are there at webinar number 2, and also in the UK tomorrow, and also there we are at webinar number 2. So if it's time wise you want to, or want to receive things, you can also join other webinars if you like. Okay Well, thanks
again,
guys. Have a good weekend.
Thanks a lot. Bye.